Hello. Hello, hello. Hello. Okay, I can see people joining. This looks like it might even be it. Do you see me? Beautiful. Okay, 7, 11. Beautiful people, you're here. Excellent. Right. Well, hello. I'm Joe Muggs. Welcome to my garage. And I am here to talk about a very beautiful album. There it is, hopefully not reflecting too much. Now, this one is a teenage epiphany one for me, so you'll have to excuse if I go misty-eyed at points. There's a lot of happy memories, teenage breakup memories, all the other kind of extra intensity that comes with hormones and early narcotic experiences. But it was a good one. 1992, 28 years ago. One of the themes I think I'll probably come back to is how bizarre it is that the music referenced on this at the time seemed impossibly ancient. All of the free jazz and experimental rock and so on of the mostly 60s, but some before and some after, that Jason Pierce or Jason Spaceman, as we knew him, picked up on for this sound that he created. All of it seemed so very, very long ago. And yet, actually, it was less than 20 years. Whereas now, this record is a lot further away in history. It's 28 years, but of course, it seems somehow more accessible. It's on Spotify. Whereas a lot of the things that we were hearing via this, or being told that it sounded like, we were reading the NME and Melody Maker, just were almost mythical. And I think that this adds to this kind of real mythical religious spirit that runs through this album. So, even the Velvet Underground hadn't really heard that much. I didn't know anyone who owned the Velvet Underground album in my little town. I'm sure someone did, but none of my friends did. Stooges, had heard a little bit of the Stooges, but Philip Glass, Sun Ra, what were these things? So when we read, we had to kind of imagine in our heads what all these influences actually were. Okay, so to give some context, yes, I should probably try and locate myself in the middle of all that. So January 1992, I'm 17, and if you have seen the link I posted on the event page for this broadcast earlier, I was, at least in part, a dedicated shoegazer. Like I think most teenagers of that era, I was split between rave. I wasn't a proper raver, but I'd been out. I knew what it was about. I was buying techno records. I knew what underground resistance and all this kind of thing were. And there was a kind of gribo side, a rocker, greasy, grubby rocker who loved Pop Police itself and gay bikers on acid and all this kind of thing. But the shoegaze thing was absolutely vital. I grew up in the Thames Valley, on the Berkshire Downs, in the Vale of the White Horse, which sounds very Game of Thrones, but was a place where, as a teenager, you had to make your own entertainment, to say the very least, and making your own entertainment generally consisted of cider and red seal and snogging in ditches. And the perfect soundtrack to that was shoegaze. Our local bands were Ride and Slow Dive and Chapter House and Spaceman 3 sat right in the middle of that. In fact, Spaceman 3 were almost a portal from that into weirder stuff. Spaceman 3 and Loop. So just as I started to get into alternative music at the age of about 15, Spaceman 3 were definitely one of the ones that kind of were more than just stoner entertainment, but seemed to kind of kick a hole in reality and signal to weirder and darker and more majestic and marvelous things on the other side, along with stuff that would pop up on the indie charts on the chart show on ITV on a Saturday morning with so that, you know, there were acts like the Butthole Surfers, like discovering early Sonic Youth, like A.R. Kane, and yeah, Spaceman 3. We loved Spaceman 3. They were this perfect pastiche rock band, in a sense. Like, they did everything to perfection. It was more than pastiche. I was watching some interviews with them earlier today, preparing for this, and their perfect bowl cuts and their perfect surliness and their perfect kind of look in the eye of being somewhere else, being like having a mind on higher things, it was too glorious, you know, for sulky indie teenagers to see this on TV and see all their oil wheels and layers of weird animation over their videos and stuff. It was majestic, and they really, more than anything, introduced us to rock music as trance, to the repetition of one chord. Again, just like, you know, we had scarcely heard the Velvet Underground or the Stooges. We certainly hadn't heard Cluster or even Can, probably. Most of these kind of krautrock bands, again, were something from the pages of the Melody Maker. They weren't stuff that came into your real life unless maybe John Peel played a reissue or something. And so we'd followed Spaceman 3 for a bit. I was lucky enough to have seen them when I was 15 at Reading Festival, and thought how wonderful and strange it was that they just sat on chairs and were sullen and played their chord for hours on end. And Spaceman 3's last album had come out after they split up in 1991. It came out, Recurring, and I don't have the album to hand, but that we particularly loved. And we were starting to realize that there were these two personalities. Well, I say realize, you couldn't fail to notice that there were these two personalities in Spaceman 3, because that final album, of which this is the lead single, ended up being split into two. So one side was made by Sonic Boom, Pete Kemba, and the other side was made by Jason Spaceman. And the second side of Recurring basically set the template for Spiritualized. It became the first half of Spiritualized album. And, you know, it was because they were these intense characters, we used to fantasize and wonder, like, wow, what kind of psychic warfare were they about? Because there were all these rumors in the inky music papers about how much they loathed each other. And, you know, you could see on their final interviews them glowering at each other. And all of this was great, but the music was quite transcendent. And what Sonic Boom did on his side and on this single, Big City, you could hear it especially, was starting to bring what we later realized was this kind of cosmische krautrock influence in, and go a bit more electronic and like let drum machines take the lead. Whereas what Jason did and would become perfect in Spiritualized was to let the pure instrument, the acoustic guitars and the trumpets and the organs and everything, all of the kind of, it wasn't even rock anymore. It was this kind of chamber sound. And then, yeah, early in 1992, Laser Guided Melodies comes, and it's perfect. I think it is a perfect record. I think it's better than Ladies and Gentlemen, We Are Floating in Space, which became their kind of signature hit album, what, 5 years later? Because that one really is, you know, it's got big budgets and it's kind of straining to reach the stars. But this one seems to just reach the stars. It reaches the wide open eternities of space with very little effort, just this constant, perfect, simple motifs. I mean, you can hear in almost every song, and it's almost one long song. It's almost, you can hear the same motifs, the same, like, one note up, one then back down, or even two note motifs, just a bass line that constantly resolves, just a bum, bum, boom, boom. All of these things keep going through, and it's these simple 1, 2, 3, and 4 note riffs weaving in and out of each other, played with such total elegance, precision, perfection, even as it sounds like a lazy stoner slacker record, that it feels like there's such an absolute exact science to it that it just creates, it's one of the reasons why I guess I ended up becoming a writer, because it creates something that you struggle to describe. And you know, I don't often use that phrase. I don't often use the phrase lost for words, but and I'm skeptical about transcendence religiosity in music in general, but there is really very, very few records in this world, certainly guitar records, that seem to describe sensations that are beyond language in the way that this does. A lot of it is to do with the keyboards, to do with these very, very simple drones, often just a single note. So in the song Sway, for example, you've just got this buzz all the way through it, and well, the guitar and the bass and the strings and the horns are all doing these beautifully harmonizing, constantly resolving motifs. You don't really notice this buzz, but every so often you're reminded it's there, and it's very hallucinatory. And it just seems to make the whole thing levitate. And the lyrics are sort of hoary. They are cheesy in that they invoke every rock and soul and gospel cliche. And yet somehow on this record, more than any other, Jason Pierce uses the simplicity of those words, you know, the cliche is, oh Lord, which is a phrase he kind of uses quite a lot. And but, you know, the word home, the word Lord, the word sway, the word run, these like incredibly simple one syllable words are used like mantras, and because of their familiarity from 60s pop and girl group music and the Beatles and Bo Diddley and all of these kind of things, he just somehow recognizes the resonance of those individual syllables in the same way that he's recognizing the resonance of one constant tone, or of a 1-4-5 chord sequence, or of a simple up and down step melody. And so it all joins this mesh, and yeah, it could go on forever. I could go on forever about this. It's a glorious, glorious record. It tells you life is sometimes bad, life is sometimes glorious. Sometimes you get really tired of it. Sometimes you want everything to stop. Sometimes you are in bliss. It's almost like that's the limit of how far it goes. So sometimes you're in love with people. Sometimes you're not in love with people. You know, that's kind of the limit of what it says. And yet these very, very simple things, just like those simple melodies, just like those simple use of words, by being boiled down to the purest versions of love, weariness, excitement, blah blah blah, just becomes incredibly profound. And I've been listening to it all week, you know, thinking about this broadcast, and it never sounds old at all. It sounds just like the greatest techno records. And I think, you know, it's no coincidence that I got into this just as I was really starting to appreciate techno at the same time, because the repetition and the subliminals and all of those things, they're all in there. And it does, you know, conjures the trance states in the same way. At Glastonbury that year, at Glastonbury 1992, which was the year of the Orb and Primal Scream playing back to back, and the Shaman playing, Terence McKenna voice kind of drifting over Acid Fried Field, and you know, a lot of electronic music kind of moving into the indie mainstream. Actually, one of the times that we danced the most was to Spiritualized set. And although it's a great album for lockdown, it's a great album for lying down on whatever depressant you like, whether that's red wine or anything else, it grooves. It's an album with a groove, and it delivers on an awful lot of different fronts, from pure comfort to an absolute adrenaline rush when you get something like the Sun Ra explosions of brass in a track like Angel Sigh, to you could sit and study it and just hear those subliminals and go, that's amazing, that's just exquisite the way he's done that. Or you can take it in its entirety, let it wash over you, and you know, it is structured like waves, it just constantly keeps coming. And it's got a sense of humor as well, and just the finale of, you think it's going to end on life sure is weird, but what else am I to know, and then it all kind of disappears. And then the final 200 bars comes in, which in any lesser hands would be a joke. It's just counting, and then him kind of droning on about spending his life in bars, and somehow that brings it back down to earth. And yet it also feels like that track could roll off into eternity, and it also becomes really profound, even though it's so mundane in its subject. Anyway, I think I probably droned enough, so maybe we should switch over to some other drones. I'm sorry. Yeah, if you all want to put the record on whatever format you have, and we will all listen together according to the classic album Sunday's guidelines, which basically mean actually sit and listen, try not to have any distractions, switch your screens off, get as much immersion as you can in this record, and we will rejoin you in the chat room here when that's all done, and hopefully we can have a bit of a further discussion about the record. We would love you to join in, and a top contributor will win a pair of Klipsch T5 in-ear headphones, which, given the quality of Klipsch gear, I'm sure are pretty decent headphones. So yeah, please come back to us when you've all played the record. And see you in, I haven't worked out how long it is, but 45 minutes or so.
Thank you.